Please note, digital files accompany this program. Simon & Schuster Audio presents The 4-Day Win, How to End Your Diet War and Achieve Thinner Peace 4 Days at a Time, by Martha Beck. Read by the author.
Chapter 1. Why are you so damn fat? Not that I think you are. No, no, no. Why, in those pants with the light behind you, you look positively willowy. But even if you were large enough to have a gravitational field involving 4 independent moons, and I happen to notice, I would never ever ask you such a cruel question. Nor would you say such a thing to me were the tables turned. No, you're only that rude and nasty to the one person you can never escape, yourself. How many times have you accused yourself of excessive heft and inappropriate texture? Squishy. How many times have you asked, why am I so damn fat? I'd try to estimate the number for myself, but I don't think it's possible to count that high. I think that if I programmed my computer to calculate the answer, it would explode. Anyway, it doesn't matter, because pretty much everyone who asks the question, why am I so damn fat, already knows the answer. After all, it's in every magazine and about half the books ever published. While the details of each diet or exercise regimen vary from publication to publication, the basic message of all the vast literature on weight loss is, drumroll, wait for it. This is so exciting. Eat less, move more. You're so damn fat because you eat too much and don't exercise enough, right? If you don't already know this, you and I aren't living in the same universe. We've been pelted with weight loss instructions from the womb. Some of my friends had parents who offered to pay them for every pound they lost in second grade. Some were weighed every morning in front of their families or classmates like livestock, but without the merciful follow-up of being slaughtered. Some actually paid to have their own jaws wired shut like volunteer subjects in some barbaric Nazi experiment. None of these people, not one, is ignorant of the basic principles of weight loss. They're some of the most intelligent, disciplined, high achievers I've ever met. All of them know many ways to eat less and move more. Is the problem that they lack willpower? Not at all. Their willpower is above average. If you've ever stayed on a diet long enough to lose weight, so is yours. No, the problem, for my friends and all the rest of us, isn't that we don't know what to do. The problem is that we don't do what we know. Why not? Contrary to conventional wisdom, the most compelling answer is not in our refrigerators, our restaurants, our mouths, our stomachs, our weak wills, or our basically vile and godless nature. It's in our heads. To get more than a few pounds over our healthiest weight, most of us have to eat more than our bodies really want. True, certain foods make us prone to overeating. I believe dietitians have now proven that high fructose corn syrup is the sweat of Satan. But even so, taking in far more calories than we need doesn't physically feel good. After the point when our appetites are sated, we're not increasing physical pleasure, we're overriding physical discomfort. By the same token, environmental factors may invite us to gorge, but they don't actually force us. Your local burger binge bonanza managers may offer all sorts of tallow-laden food, but no one's holding you at gunpoint until you order and consume every last French fry in a king-size super trough. Bottom line, eating is a deliberate behavior, however compelling. Like all deliberate behavior, even if we do it without really thinking about it, the process of eating must be okayed by our brains before it reaches the action stage. I know firsthand what it's like to spend years feeling completely out of control in any area connected with food and eating. Many of my clients have been there too. But we've also seen and felt what it's like to be set free from the struggle to control our weight. My experience and research tell me that these liberations didn't occur because we finally found the right diet or achieved superhuman willpower. They happened when we finally learned to operate our minds and thoughts in ways that, as science has now proven, literally altered our brains. Why are you so damn fat? At the most fundamental and important level, it's because of the way your brain has been conditioned to operate, because of the way you think. And that's what this audiobook is going to help you change. There's changing your mind, and then there's changing your mind. I reached this conclusion after 20 years of intense study, research, and observation on the subject of weight loss. I began as an undergraduate at Harvard, trying to determine why eating disorders, so prevalent in the USA, were almost unheard of in Asia. The answer, I came to believe, isn't physiological as much as it is philosophical, but we'll get to that later. The reason this topic appealed to me was that, like many other college students, I had a hell of an eating disorder, and I use the word hell advisedly. It started as a simple diet, then morphed into an extended ride on the gain-lose roller coaster. In hindsight, I can now see that my attempts to control my body size actually created a syndrome I call famine brain, which drew my behavior and attention to eating until my whole life became a struggle with food. This was one of the most horrible things I've ever experienced. It's the real reason I'm writing this book. I never want any other human being to feel the way I felt when binging, dieting, and obsessing about binging and dieting constituted my entire psychological universe. It was like one long, hideous visit from the Spanish Inquisition. As I went on to get my master's and PhD degrees, also from Harvard, which by some tragic judgment error just kept admitting me, I became fascinated by sociobiology and social psychology, including the psychology of eating. I was particularly interested in the way the mind reacts to eating problems. What, I wondered, was going on in the brains of people like me? People who knew exactly how to stay thin, but somehow just couldn't do it. I read everything I could find on the subject. Since no one, at that time, could watch the human brain in action, the answers I found were sparse and incomplete. Still, they were better than nothing, and I began to emerge from weight obsession. By the time I'd finished my doctorate, I had already become something that probably made my Harvard professors roll their eyes and groan, a life coach. Academia was never as exciting for me as applying social science in the lives of real people. Hearing about my clients' lives and watching them change was mesmerizing. In case you're wondering, a life coach is to a therapist as a personal trainer is to a doctor. Psychotherapists work with damaged minds to make them well. I counsel people who are mentally healthy but feel that they could do more with their lives. Since I believe that each person innately knows what his or her best life should be, my coaching is all about helping clients tune into their unconscious, unrealized dreams, then making those dreams come true. As I developed more and more effective coaching strategies, I noticed an interesting trend. Many of my clients were dropping excess weight, even though we hadn't talked about weight loss and they weren't dieting. I began paying more attention to this phenomenon and even wrote a self-help book called The Joy Diet, which recommended several small lifestyle changes that I'd found were correlated with weight loss. This led to a joint project with the diet company Jenny Craig, whose wonderful, cutting-edge researchers collaborated with me in creating a DVD that helped their customers with the psychological side of weight loss. All of these projects were fascinating, but things got even more exciting when computer technology reached a level of sophistication that allowed scientists to create brain maps, images of the brain at work. Suddenly, scientists can literally map what's happening in the brain of a person with, say, ADD or compulsive cravings. It turns out that certain ways of thinking can literally change the structure of the brain, for example, in ways that make it less prone to craving and more prone to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.